Interrupt the regular program schedule to bring you the following special report from ABC News in Washington. Here is Steve Bell.
Good evening. We're about to witness history in several respects. Nelson A. Rockefeller, confirmed by the House of Representatives earlier this evening by a margin of more than 2-1. Mr. Rockefeller will be sworn in tonight as the 41st Vice President of the United States. Nelson Rockefeller will, along with Gerald Ford, become the first team of President and Vice President ever to serve this country who have not been elected by the people. The swearing-in ceremony tonight in the Senate chamber will mark the first time there has been a live television broadcast from the Senate. There was one live radio broadcast. That was back in 1929 when Herbert Hoover was sworn in as President of the United States. We are anticipating a slight delay in the beginning of this ceremony. The President of the United States on his way over from the White House.
Michigan, Mr. Griffin. Senator from Utah, Mr. Moore.
The President pro tem of the Senate will be the presiding officer this evening, Senator James Eastland. Interestingly enough, Senator Mike Mansfield, the majority leader, is not in the country. He's in China. Nelson Rockefeller, undergoing 4 months of scrutiny since his nomination by Gerald Ford to be the 41st Vice President, he was approved in the House Judiciary Committee by a vote of 26-12, then in the Senate by 90-7, and earlier this evening, the House vote to confirm Rockefeller was 287-128, and that was at the end of 6 hours of strenuous debate. The issues, of course, the possible conflict of interest with the great wealth of the Rockefeller family. Some $20 million given by the Rockefeller family over the years to advance the political career of Nelson Rockefeller.
Speaker of the House of Representatives and the joint bipartisan leadership.
Those now entering the chamber, the House leaders, Speaker Carl Albert of Oklahoma, Majority Leader Thomas O'Neill, John McFaul, the Majority Whip, Peter Rodino, Chairman of Judiciary, John Rhodes, the Minority Leader, Leslie Ahrens, Minority Whip, John Anderson, Chairman of the House Republican Conference, Edward Hutchinson, the ranking Republican on the Judiciary Committee.
Gentlemen, you are welcome to the Senate.
The next dignitary to enter will be Chief Justice Warren Berger, who will be escorted by the Deputy Sergeant at Arms, Robert Huff. The Chief Justice tonight will be swearing in the new Vice President. There's Senator Eastland, President pro tem, presiding over the swearing in ceremony. Vice President-to-be Nelson Rockefeller flying to Washington from New York late today with his wife, Happy, two sons, Nelson Jr., 10, and Mark, 7, as well as a number of the political leaders from New York State. Mayor Abe Beam will be here, Governor-elect Hugh Carey, Governor and Mrs. Malcolm Wilson. It was Wilson who served Rockefeller so many years as Lieutenant Governor.
Mr. Secretary.
The Chief Justice of the United States.
Now the Chief Justice, Warren Berger, in his robe, escorted by the Deputy Sergeant at Arms. In just a few moments now, President Gerald Ford will be entering. For him, this will be the second time for a ceremony of this nature. He himself, of course, sworn in after selection as Vice President without a vote of the people. In that case, to replace the resigned Spiro Agnew and to serve Richard Nixon. President Ford and Vice President-to-be Nelson Rockefeller both selected for the vice presidential office under the terms of the 25th Amendment, the succession amendment.
Best behavior we've had, yeah.
Returning to the issue of the controversies which delayed for some 4 months the confirmation of Nelson Rockefeller, not only the family money, the fact that he had given out more than $600,000 in personal gifts to political associates. And many of those who opposed his nomination brought up the fact that the confirmation vote from the House would include 92 so-called lame duck representatives, namely those who have been defeated or retired.
President,
the Secretary,
the President of the United States.
Now President Ford stumbling briefly there. Mrs. Ford on her right, Mr. Seidman, the economic counselor, Senator Scott, the minority leader, directly behind the President. Mr. Ford, of course, a favorite among members of the Congress, both sides of the aisle, an extremely popular colleague during his many years in the House, the last years as the Republican leader in the House of Representatives. Ironic that this same man as president has already set a record for vetoes.
Senate, come to order.
And now we're about to have the introduction of Nelson Rockefeller, who will be escorted not only by the Sergeant at Arms, but also the Escort Committee. That Escort Committee made up of Minority Leader Scott.
Have order. The chair now appoints the Chief Justice of the United States to administer the oath in my behalf to the Vice President of the United States.
Unless we've missed something here, we still have one more man to enter the chamber. The Chief Justice walking across to join the President. However, we still await the arrival of Nelson Rockefeller. There's Mrs. Rockefeller and their two sons, Governor Averill Harriman, a Democrat but a longtime friend of Nelson Rockefeller, sitting directly behind Mrs. Rockefeller, who of course has faced surgery twice in recent months, first September 28th, then on the 25th of November. In the escort group that will be leading Nelson Rockefeller into the chamber, as we said, Minority Leader Scott, also the Majority Whip, Robert Byrd of West Virginia, Howard Cannon, Chairman of the Rules Committee, Senator Marlo Cook of Kentucky, the ranking Republican on Rules, and the two senators from New York, Jacob Javits and James Buckley, the Conservative.
Mr. Secretary.
Mr. President, the Vice President Designate of the United States.
Now the moment. Nelson A. Rockefeller, who for so many years sought the presidency itself, like the president before him, tripping over that last little step. A wave to Mrs. Rockefeller and sons Nelson Jr. and Mark. Nelson Rockefeller saying today, yes, this is the last of the political road for him, the vice presidency. Former governor of the state of New York, several times Republican candidate, or candidate for the Republican nomination. The Bible he's holding, a family Bible, once belonged to the wife of John D. Rockefeller, the original Rockefeller millionaire.
Senator, come to order.
Nelson, glad to see you.
Raise your right hand and repeat after me. I, Nelson Aldrich Rockefeller.
I, Nelson Aldrich Rockefeller.
Do solemnly swear.
Do solemnly swear.
That I will support and defend.
That I will support and defend.
The Constitution of the United States.
The Constitution of the United States.
Against all enemies, foreign and domestic.
Against all enemies, foreign and domestic.
That I will bear true faith and allegiance to the same.
That I will bear true faith and allegiance to the same.
That I take this obligation freely.
That I take this obligation freely.
Without any mental reservation or purpose of evasion.
Without any mental reservation or purpose of evasion.
And that I will well and faithfully discharge.
And that I will well and faithfully discharge.
The duties of the office.
The duties of the office.
On which I am about to enter.
On which I am about to enter.
So help me God.
So help me God.
With this moment, history for the United States of America. A president and a vice president, duly installed in office but without a vote of the people. Both men coming to office through the 25th Amendment to the Constitution of the United States. They will be signing the official book, and each will receive a ceremonial pen. Then Senator Robert Byrd will ask the unanimous consent of the Senate for the Vice President to be authorized to speak. And Vice President Rockefeller is expected to speak for about 5 minutes. Almost his only constitutional duty, of course, to preside over this very same Senate body. Of course, there is already speculation as to what duties Vice President Rockefeller will perform for President Ford. Each time we get a new vice president, there are always many words about how many responsibilities he will have. And yet each time we
Senate, come to order. Have one, he
seems frustrated
President,
in
I
office.
I ask unanimous consent that the Vice President of the United States be permitted to address the Senate at this time.
Without objection, so ordered.
Vice President Rockefeller.
Mr. President, Mr. Speaker, President Pro Tem Eastland, Mr. Chief Justice, Your Excellencies, the member of the Diplomatic Corps, distinguished guests, and fellow Americans. As I stand before you, I feel a great sense of humility. I feel a great sense of gratitude for the privilege of serving the country I love. I feel a deep sense of gratitude to President Ford, to the Congress of the United States, and to the people of America. To the President for his trust and confidence and the opportunity he has given me to serve this great nation in working with him. A man for whom I have profound respect, admiration, and warmth of affection. A man of integrity, sincerity, openness, dedication. A man bearing the lonely burdens of the presidency with deep human understanding and total devotion to his country. And my admiration to the First Lady, Betty Ford, and her great warmth and her courage. And if you'll forgive me for a personal note, my love and admiration to my own gallant wife, Happy. I feel deeply grateful to the committees and the members of the United States Senate and the House of Representatives for their confirmation of my nomination. Among the many reasons I look forward with pride and with keen anticipation to serving the Senate as their presiding officer is the fact that my mother's father, my grandfather, Senator Nelson W. Aldrich, represented the great state of Rhode Island in this very chamber for 31 years after serving for 3 years in the House of Representatives. The thoroughness with which the Congress exercised its responsibilities on behalf of the American people under the 25th Amendment has been another dramatic evidence of the enduring strength and vitality of our Constitution and our unique American system. I've learned a great deal from this experience of the past 4 months. And I've come out of it with an even greater respect for the Congress of the United States, a more profound appreciation of the collective wisdom of the American people as expressed through the Congress, and a deeper understanding of the breadth of the responsibility to the people of this great free land that falls upon those of us in positions of public trust. I deeply appreciate the outstanding work of all those in government agencies involved in the investigation and preparation of material for the congressional committees. I admire and respect the vigilant coverage of the free American press, radio, and television through which the people of America were so well informed. I would like to thank all of those citizens who participated directly in the process by expressing themselves to their representatives in the Senate and in the House, and to those who sent words of encouragement to Happy and to me. And finally, especially to you, Mr. Chief Justice, my thanks for your administering the oath and symbolizing, as you do, the rule of law by which this great republic functions. This is a period in which our country faces tremendous difficulties and unprecedented problems, both at home and abroad. Problems that affect every section of our country and every family in America. But there is nothing wrong with America that Americans cannot right. I pledge myself to the fullest limit of my capacity to work with you, Mr. President, and the Congress in the great task of building the strength of America to meet the grave new problems which we confront as a nation and as a people. I thank you.
President Rockefeller, concluding his remarks, the line that will be remembered, unprecedented problems, but there's nothing wrong with America that Americans can't right. And now the President pro tem will call for order, and Senator Byrd, acting for the Majority Leader, we'll ask for the absence of a quorum.
Mr. President. Mr. Vice President. Mr. Speaker. Mr. President of the Senate pro tempore. At this historic moment in the existence of this distinguished body, I offer congratulations to the Vice President of the United States. And on behalf of our majority leader and my other colleagues in the Senate of the United States, I welcome the Vice President as the presiding officer of this body. There was a time in the history of this republic when the Vice President's role as President of the Senate was perhaps the highest responsibility of the office. But that is no longer true. In today's world, the office of Vice President of the United States has assumed an importance and a significance with which it was not formerly associated. As the stature of the Vice Presidency has increased, so have the responsibilities. Therefore, Mr. Vice President, we wish you well as you prepare to take your place in the administration and the conduct of the nation's affairs, and I repeat the welcome of this body to you as President of the Senate of the United States.
Pennsylvania is recognized.
Mr. President, Mr. Vice President, Mr. President Pro Tem, Mr. Chief Justice, members of the House of Representatives, Mr. Speaker, and members, I have a great privilege at this point, and I would like to say first that I congratulate the Vice President upon his opportunity to serve and to serve with the President and the Congress of the United States. Such a privilege is rare and is one to be earned, and I am certain that we are all going to benefit and to rejoice in this new move and advance along our constitutional path. The 25th Amendment has worked, and we are all very proud to have had a part in it. Mr. President, on behalf of myself and the distinguished acting majority leader, I submit a resolution, and I will read it and ask then for its immediate consideration.
Clerk will report it.
Could you stop for yourself and Mr. Robert C. Byrd? Submit the following resolution. Whereas the nomination of Nelson A. Rockefeller to be Vice President of the United States was submitted to the Congress for confirmation on August 20th, 1974, and whereas Nelson A. Rockefeller has today taken the oath of office as the 41st Vice President of the United States, now therefore be it resolved that the Senate congratulates the Vice President on assuming his new duties and wishes him well during his term of office. Resolve that an engrossed copy of this resolution shall be transmitted to the Vice President.
President,
Pennsylvania.
I renew my request for the immediate consideration of the resolution.
Without objection, the resolution is adopted.
Two speeches by Senators Byrd and Scott and the resolution are late additions to the schedule. They were not anticipated earlier in the day.
That's the way we do it in the Senate, all the babies.
And there is the new Vice President moving up into the chair of the presiding officer of the United States Senate. Congressman Rodino, the Judiciary Committee, a man who had very much to do, one might say, with Nelson Rockefeller being here tonight. Still trying the chair out for size.
Senate will come to order, please. Senator from West Virginia. I know him very well, too.
Excuse me. Mr. President, I suggest the absence of a quorum.
The clerk will call the roll.
Well, there you have the first official act of Nelson Rockefeller as Vice President of the United States. Assuming the chair, presiding over the Senate long enough for Senator Byrd to suggest the absence of a quorum. And now the roll is called. And this, in effect, is a device to allow the president and the vice president to leave gracefully while the members are still engaged in procedure. Senator Javits there behind Vice President Rockefeller. Congressman Rodino of the Judiciary Committee. This entire ceremony taking less than 30 minutes time. The historic swearing in of the 41st Vice President of the United States, Nelson Rockefeller, who will serve President Gerald Ford. In his speech, Vice President Rockefeller saying that he learned a great deal from the 4 months of inquiry that went into his nomination. He said he has now greater respect for the Congress and the people who elect the Congress, greater understanding of the responsibilities of those who serve in a public trust. And there was praise for the press, radio, television, and the investigating agencies. This has been live coverage, an historic first, live coverage by television in the Senate chambers of the United States, the swearing in of Nelson Rockefeller after his confirmation by House vote earlier in the evening. Nelson Rockefeller, 41st Vice President of the United States. This is Steve Bell, ABC News in Washington. I'm going to get you in order.
This special report has come to you from ABC News, Washington. We now resume our regular program schedule following station identification.